and welcome to today's session on the income statement within Power BI. So here we have our income statement example. Firstly, we can see that we're showing the performance for May. And once we look at performance for May, on the left-hand side, we have our traditional income statement. This income statement shows the breakdown from gross revenue all the way through to profit after tax. Below that, we have all our various margin calculations. So for instance, gross profit divided by gross revenue, EBITDA divided by gross revenue, and profit after tax divided by gross revenue. If we go further along to the right-hand side, we have what I think is the highest value add of this report, and this shows the profit after tax bridge. This breaks down how we get from budgeted profit after tax of 352k all the way down to 379k, which is our actual figure. We can see that that results in a positive variance of 27k. So let's focus on the left-hand side, looking at our income statement actuals. We can see here that we've got from our gross revenue of 770k all the way down to our 379k profit after tax. All of the negative numbers have brackets around them. So for instance, operating expenses of 209k is a negative to the actuals. Any area that's highlighted in grey is a subtotal. So for instance, net invoice revenue is a subtotal of gross revenue and discounts. Net revenue is the net invoice revenue less any returns and adjustments. Gross profit is the net revenue subtracting any cost of sales. EBITDA takes the gross profit and subtracts all of the operating expenses. And profit before interest and tax takes the EBITDA subtracting depreciation and amortization. Our profit before tax takes away the interest, and finally we get to our profit after tax once our tax is subtracted. This income statement is the same for both budget and forecast, which we have to the right hand side. After that, however, we start looking at our variances. So firstly, we look at the variance versus budget in both numerical and percentage terms, and then we look at the variance versus forecast in both numerical and percentage terms. So for instance, you can see that gross revenue was a positive variance of 21k versus budget, which is 2.8%. We know this is a positive variance because our actuals were 770k, where our budget was 749k, which is resulting in our 21k positive variance. And we know it's positive because we've highlighted it in green. Conversely, all of our negative variances are highlighted in red. So for instance, if we look at our intercompany revenue, this was 1k less than expected versus budget. We know that's less than because it's in brackets, and we know that's a negative variance because it's in red. If we go down to the cost of sales line, we can see that we have a negative variance of 8k. We know that's a negative variance because it's highlighted in red. And if we look at the cost of sales, we can see that the cost of sales are 118k higher than they were in the budget. In the case of cost of sales, a higher actuals than budget is a negative variance. The less we spend on cost of sales, the greater our end profit is. So that's the income statement explained. We're now going to move on to look at the profit after tax bridge, which I think adds an awful lot of value to this report. We can see this bridge gets us from our budgeted profit after tax of 352k all the way through to our actual profit after tax of 379k, and this is representing a 27k positive movement. The nice thing about the bridge is it shows us all of the movements in numerical terms, whilst highlighting all the material elements. So the positive material movements in this example are our operating revenue, which is 21k, which represents 79.2% of our positive movement, and our marketing spend, which is 19k, which represents 68.9% of our positive movement. We can see that this is partially offset by our cost of sales negative material movement of 8k. Which represents 30.4% of our negative movement. So overall, if we want to explain how we ended up with a positive 27k variance against budget, we can see this is primarily made up of better than expected operating revenue held at similar margins to before. We can also see that we had a positive underspend of marketing of 19k. Next, let's look here at the bottom right hand side. Here we can see that we have both budget and forecast. By selecting forecast, we can actually change the visual so that it flips from looking at budgeted profit after tax to forecasted profit after tax. Whilst the numbers are updated to show the forecasted profit after tax at the top, the actual figure remains exactly the same. And we can see that now we only have a 1K positive variance. So now if we want to explain how we got from our forecasted profit after tax to our actual profit after tax, we can do that as well as from our budget. The other thing that we can do with this visual is we can change between looking at the current month to looking at the quarter to date and the year to date. And this is in the top right hand corner. If I select quarter to date, hopefully you'll notice that all the numbers have changed and the title now reads performance for Q2. Similarly, if I click on year to date, the title also changes to performance for May year to date and all the numbers update. So now that I've shown you what the report looks like, let's go into a little bit more detail and see how this was actually built. So here we have our income statement laid out in three different levels, level 1, level 2 and level 3. And you can see hopefully that this goes from gross revenue through to profit after tax. We have three different levels because there are further levels behind each of those level 1s. So for instance, gross revenue is broken out into operating revenue and intercompany revenue. Operating revenue is then further broken out into business to business revenue and business to consumer revenue. Bear in mind, this income statement is just an example. You would need to tailor this example in order to be in line with your income statement. So once you've got your own income statement laid out, what you next need to do is to add in where you want the blank lines. So here, for example, I want a blank line between discounts and net invoice revenue. And this creates that nice sort of spacing that we've got within the report. Just to remind you what that looks like, we have our blank line here on our income statement, which generates this gap between our discounts and our net invoice revenue, which is our subtotal. With all the blank lines within your income statement, you need to label them with a various different unique identifier. So I've used blank 1, blank 2, blank 3, blank 4, blank 5, and blank 6, and blank 7. So these are all unique identifiers that I can use when sorting my columns later. In our level 1 and 2, we've just got those underlines, which are just there to show the special effect within the report. So once we've got all our blank lines in, the next thing we need to do is add our forecasted and our budgeted profit after tax to the bottom. These aren't used in the income statement themselves, but are used in that bridge where we go from our budgeted or our forecast all the way through to our actual profit after tax. The next step is to add some additional columns. So we have our level 1, our level 2, and our level 3. By default, these will be sorted alphabetically. Actually, what we want to do is we want to be able to order these each individual levels in order to create the correct layout for our income statement. So we start off with our level 1 order, which relates to our level 1, our level 2 order, which relates to level 2, and level 3 order, which relates to level 3. You can see here I started at 1 and gone all the way down to number 22 for our level 1 order. Budgeted profit after tax and the forecasted profit after tax, I switched to using negative numbers, and this is because we want these to appear at the top of our bridge. So once we've got our order sorted, the next thing we want to do is we want to decide what to highlight and what not to highlight on our income statement. And we can see that in column G. If we go back to our report, you can see that certain lines are highlighted. So for instance, net invoiced, net revenue, gross profit, EBITDA, profit before interest and tax, profit before tax, and profit after tax are all highlighted lines. After we've decided which lines to highlight on our income statement, we also need to decide which are our main income statement lines. These are all the lines excluding the blanks and excluding the budgeted profit after tax and forecasted profit after tax. The final column we need to add is column I, which is just a true flag for each individual blank line. So now let's move on to our next tab, and this is our ledger mapping. This shows the subledger mapping through to that level 3 that we created in the previous tab. Each company usually has a set of subledgers, and these map back towards your income statement. So for instance, subledger 101000 maps back to business revenue. The next tab we have shows the income statement roll up. This shows the level 3 on both the columns and the rows, and it also shows how they map together. So for instance, business to business revenue is mapped to business revenue. Business to consumer revenue is mapped to consumer revenue, and so on and so forth. Where this becomes interesting is where you have the net invoice revenue. Here you have to flag everywhere where net invoice revenue is flagged towards another one of those level threes. So for instance, net invoice revenue is comprised of business-to-business revenue, business-to-consumer revenue, intercompany revenue, standard discount, and other discount. If we go further down the income statement, we see that net revenue has the same as net invoice revenue, but also has standard returns and other adjustments mapped to it, and so on and so forth. And you would need to build this out for your own organisation. The next tab that you see shows the actuals. This is a very straightforward tab. It shows the organisational key, which we can use to identify the different organisations. So we've got revenue in our company in France, UK, Spain, amongst others. We have the subledgers, which are our ledger accounts, which are mapped to our income statements. And then we simply have the date and the value. Once we have the actuals data, the next thing we do is bring in the budgeted and forecasted data. The budget data and forecast data are both set at level 3 level, so we wouldn't usually set this sub-ledger level. We see here that we've got the level 3, the organisational key, and all the dates and values. And that's the same for both budget and the forecast. We also have a date table within our model, and this is pretty standard. You would usually have a date. So for instance, we've got date, year, month, quarter, the month number, the year and month, and then we've got a few flags to flag the current month, current quarter, and current year. Obviously within your database, you wouldn't be having these static, you'd be calculating them dynamically. The final tab that we have is our organisational mapping, which just shows our organisational keys and which geographies they map to. So now we've looked at all the data inputs, let's pop over to Power BI and see how we bring all this together. Within Power BI, I'd like to start looking at our data model. The reason I want to start with the data model is this is the end state that we're looking for within our actuals. It's important to look at the end state because then you can understand how we get from the previous data we showed you, which is the Excel, to this end state data model within Power BI. So on the left-hand side, we've got our income statement layout and our mapping. Our income statement layout is exactly as we expect it from the Excel. So it contains our levels 1 to level 3 for our income statement. This is then linked to our mapping table, which contains all of our subledger detail and how this maps back to each of those individual lines. Note that we don't have a relationship between mapping and actuals. And actually what we do within the DAX is we create this relationship using something called TreeTAS. So now we've looked at the data model, let's go into transform data and look at the query editor. Within the query editor, let's first look at our actuals. Our actuals contain, exactly as we'd expect, the organisational key, subledger, date and value. The next tab shows the income statement layout. This shows level 1, level 2, level 3, the orders and all the true and false flags that we created. To start off with, let's go across to the blank line and filter down to the null values. We'll be bringing the trues back in later on. So now let's look at the ledger mapping and how the mapping table works. So the ledger mapping table itself, which shows the subledger map up to the level 3, is not actually loaded into the model. And you can see that if you right click on ledger mapping. The mapping table, however, forms a critical part of the report. So let's see how this works. To start with, we have our level 3 mapping. Now, if you remember, this showed how our business-to-business revenue is mapped to business-to-business revenue, business-to-customer revenue is mapped to business-to-customer revenue, and so on and so forth. The first thing we do with this data is we unpivot it. And that creates two columns, level 3 and level 3 detail, in all of the mapping. The next thing we do is we then merge this in conjunction with our ledger mapping table. This creates an additional column on the right-hand side. We then expand this additional column to give us a list of all of our subledgers. We filter out all of the blanks and zeros. And finally, we just sort out and change all our data types. We're also going to need our date table, so just make sure that that's loaded in as well. Let's close and apply and go back to our model. So the first thing to do is to go to the income statement layout and sort out all your sort orders. So for level 1, you need to make sure you sort by column and choose the level 1 order. If you do the same for level 2 and level 3 as well. Once that's done, just pop back to your query editor, select the income statement layout, and remove that filtered rows on the blank lines. The reason you need to do it this way around is that because you've got duplicates of the lines within the level 1 and level 2, it won't allow you to use the sort order. For instance, if I try and do the sort order now with the lines in, it will no longer allow it. We can close this warning box. If we just go over to our visualization tab, and we go over to a blank page and we drag our level 1 column on, you can see that it's maintained at the sort order, even though it's now saying that you can no longer use that. The next thing we need to do after this is we need to join up our data model. So on our data modeling tab, if it hasn't already, create the one-to-many relationship between our income statement layout and our mapping. Once that's done, just make sure that your date is joined up to your actuals table as well. And once that's done, you're ready to go and start writing some of your DAX and bringing together some of the logic. This is a blank page within our income statement Power BI file. The first thing we're going to do is add in a matrix visual here on the right hand side. With this matrix visual on the page, I'm just going to make it slightly larger so we can actually see it. Once we have our blank visual, let's add our level 1 and level 2 from our income statement layout onto the rows. The first piece of DAX we're going to look at is a very simple sum. The DAX for this is very straightforward. It is simply the sum of all the actuals value. If I now put this GL sum onto the values, what we see is the same value repeated for every single line of the income statement. The reason for this is we have no relationship between our actuals and our income statement. Let's just remind ourselves what that looks like. Here we see the mapping table on the left hand side, and as mentioned, we have no relationship across to the actuals. Instead of using a relationship, we're going to create a virtual relationship using TreeTAS, and this is done in this calculation GL amount TreeTAS. You can see here we're calculating the GL sum, which is the other measure we created, and we're using TreeTAS in order to create a relationship between our mapping table and our actuals table. When we put this onto the values, we see that we have a different value for each layer of the income statement. The next piece of DAX we have is one called blank line, which is simply identifying a blank line within the income statement. You can see here all the blank lines have a zero against them. And the final calculation is the actuals calculation. This is identifying where the income statement line is true and also including all of those blank lines. We need the income statement line is true to remove the forecasted profit after tax and the budgeted profit after tax from our income statement actuals calculation. If we now delete all the other lines, you'll see that we end up with the actuals as we would expect. The next step we're going to do is bring in the remaining data from our query editor. Let's open that up now. Here we have the query editor, and the first data we're going to bring in is our budget. You can see here we've got our budget data. If I go to the navigation step on the right hand side, you can see how it was originally within the Excel. I simply click to unpivot the columns in order to put all the dates down the rows, change the types, and then filtered out any blanks, because we don't want those within our data. Exactly the same steps have been done for the forecast, which is laid out in the same way. And the final table we're going to bring in from Excel is our organisational mapping, and we're just going to bring this in exactly as it was. The next set of tables are manual tables which have been created within Power BI itself. We have a measures table, which is just blank, and we're using that to store all our measures. We have a selected comparison, which allows us to choose either our forecast or our budget on our filter. We have selected margin, which is all our margin calculations that we want to include and the order in which we want to display these. And we have a selected period, which shows our current month, year to date and quarter to date. Now that we have all our data, let's join up our data model in its entirety. The first thing we need to do from a data modelling perspective is we need to make sure that our actuals are connected to our organisational mapping. This is here on the right hand side. With organisational mapping on our canvas, we just need to make sure that it's connected between the organisational key to the actuals. This is a one-to-many relationship. If we go over to the budget tabs and the forecast tabs, these should be connected in exactly the same way. Back on our visualisation pane, the first thing that you're going to need to do is to write the DAX for the budget and the forecast, and just repeat the process that we did for actuals. Once done, you should get a view that looks something like this. The next step then is to add in all the variances. The variances are simply a calculation of actuals less budget or divided by budget. Here we have our income statement with our actuals, budget, forecast and all our variances. Currently, however, this is showing all of the data. And if you remember the original diagram that I showed you, you were able to select the current month, the course to date or the year to date. To do that, we need to introduce some new DAX. The process for creating this DAX is the same for all the measures. In all instances, you need to create a measure for the current month, the course to date and the year to date. So on the right hand side here, I'm showing you the actuals, current month, course to date and year to date. Once done, you need to create a selected period measure. This takes the selected value from the selected period table. Where the appropriate text is identified, it will then replace it with an associated measure. So current month is replaced with actuals current month, course to date is replaced with actuals course to date, and year to date has an associated actuals year to date. Let's see how this works in practice. This visual is showing our selected period and our various actuals measures. We can see that the actuals, actuals current month, actuals course to date and actuals year to date are all showing exactly the same value. Our actuals selected period, however, is showing an appropriate value depending on the selected period. So where the row is current month, it's returning the current month measure. Where the row is course to date, it's returning the course to date measure. And finally, when it's showing year to date, it's returning the year to date measure. I'm now going to take you through the major steps that I've taken in order to get the report looking as I have. If you want to see exactly how this is done, you can look at the PBIX file, which will show you exactly what formatting settings I've chosen for each individual field. The first thing to note is that I've renamed all of my selected period measures within the visual themselves. You do this by going over to the visual and double clicking on the measure. Here, for instance, I'm using the name actuals, where the measure being used is actuals selected period. The next significant thing I've done is I've used the field formatting to turn all of my numbers into thousands. And I've changed the style to none. I've used conditional formatting quite heavily within this report. I've used conditional formatting in order to generate the red for negative numbers and the green for positive numbers within the report. And I've used a background colour within the blank lines in order to show the grayed out bar. The other thing that I've done is I've added in our second layer to our report. So if we go back and we put in our level 2 into our rows from our income statement layout, we go down to the row headers and we scroll down and we add the plus minus icons, I've expanded all the relevant levels. So gross revenue is expanded. And we also need to expand all our operating expenses. And actually our returns and adjustments also need to be expanded. Once that's done, I've then re-hidden those plus minus icons. So here we have that income statement with all of those changes made. As mentioned at the beginning, just make sure you refer to the PBIX if you want to see the exact calculations in the exact way that I'm setting up this particular report. The likelihood is, however, you'll want to slightly modify it for your own income statement. The next visual I've created is all our margin calculations. So for instance, our gross profit divided by our gross revenue. These have been created in a very similar way to the other measures, And for instance, if you select the current month, quarter date or year to date, they will change. They are, however, also dependent on another table that we brought in, which has got all our gross profit, EBITDA and profit after tax measures within it. To create the bridge, we have a few additional steps. This mainly involves a few additional calculations. The first thing we need to do is we need to calculate the bridge budget movement. This is taking our actuals, subtracting from our budget. The next thing we need to do is we need to calculate all our subtotals, which is our bridge budget and actuals measure. The first thing that we do is we calculate a variable for our budget total from our budget selected period, and we use the all statement to remove the filter context. I'm also storing the movement here as a variable. Finally, I'm creating a variable called highlighted. This variable is flagging all the different rows for which we should be calculating the subtotal. The final step is to bring it all together, which is to add our budget total to our movement and return this value everywhere where highlighted is greater than zero. The other measure here on the right-hand side, which is showing a 1 or a minus 1, is used in order to determine the conditional formatting. Simply put, I want a 1 where I want to highlight in green and a minus 1 where I want to highlight in red. The threshold I've set for this is minus 0.1 and plus 0.1, but you can set your own thresholds. So if the variance is a 10% positive or more, it will give us a green. If it's a 10% or less, it will give us a red. I've followed the same process in order to create the forecasted movement. And then I've used the same selected measure approach in order to change between the bridge for the budget and the bridge for the forecast. Once this is done, you should end up with a visual that looks something like this. The next step is then to add in a page background. So here, if you go over to Add Image, select your image, and just make sure the transparency is set to zero and that it fits into your page, you'll end up with a background that looks something like this. Finally, I've added in a dynamic title in the top left-hand corner. This is just choosing which of the selected measures I've got and returning the appropriate performance. So when I select current month, it returns the current month value. Quarter date, it returns the current quarter. And year to date, returns the year to date value. This is a common technique, but if you've not used it before, just refer to the Power BI file, which will show you how to create this. Thank you for listening to today's session on the income statement within Power BI. I've been Chris Barber, and if you've got any questions, please post them in the comments below.